Welcome to the Profit versus Growth Strategic Showdown. We have our wonderful contestants in the ring today. So let them introduce themselves. Just to start off really quickly, I'm Becky Trowbridge. I'm the digital marketing manager here at EcomEngine, and I'm moderating today. So I'll hand it over to Colleen to tell you a little more about EcomEngine and what she does.
Sure. So I'm Colleen Quattlebaum. I'm the director of marketing at EcomEngine. I work side by side with Becky every day to help Amazon sellers, just providing more helpful resources for all of you. We also have several tools that help Amazon sellers grow their business through reviews with Feedback 5 and with FBA inventory forecasting decisions through our tool Restock Pro. But looking forward to being here and sharing my perspective on growth and profit.
Awesome. Caroline.
Hi, I'm Caroline Powell, the director of marketing relationships and community. Sometimes that's a little bit of a tongue twister to get out at SellerSpy, and we are focused on funding for e-commerce businesses. It's usually a really hard place to find funding. Traditional banks are less than willing to give loans, and so we're here to provide what businesses need in order to scale. Chad, I think you're next.
Okay, cool. Hi, everybody. Chad Rubin here. Started Prophecy after selling Skubana. So I've been collaborating with everyone on this call for quite a long time. Prophecy dynamically changes your price for private label brands to maximize profit without sacrificing your ranking position on Amazon. We're seeing about a 10 to 15% lift. Excited to be here and to debate.
Great. Stephen, you're up.
I'm Stephen Pope. I'm the founder of My Amazon Guy. I'm famous for Ask Me Anything on YouTube. I run a 400-person marketing agency, and I'm excited to get Mike Tyson by Chad today in round one.
Great. Well, before we get started, we want to hear from all of you. So I'm going to launch a quick poll. Just want to see, are you more focused on growth or profit right now? Answers coming in.
Hosts and panelists cannot vote. Can't rig it.
Nope. And I will just say a little bit of housekeeping while you all are answering. We are recording the webinar today. We'll be sending out the recording after the debate today. And ask us anything. Like Stephen just said, he's a pro. Ask us questions, throw whatever you want at us, especially if it's related to growth or profit. We'll be kind of teeing up some conversation and then plenty of time to let all of you give us questions. So we're happy to answer them. Looks like we're almost done with the poll. Go ahead and end
this. Going to be a close match here.
Yeah, so sharing the results, we've got kind of a tie, split about third everywhere, 30% growth and profit, and trying to focus on both. So be interesting to see what you all think. So I wanted to kick it off talking about profitability. So it's just going to open the floor. You know, why do we care about profitability? What kind of tips do you have? When do you focus on it? Just dive right in. So Chad, I'm going to hand it off to you.
Yeah. So I think we've entered a new era with inflation across PPC and raw materials and salary inflations in e-com. Right, we sort of entered into the e-com winter, and I think we've moved away from growth at any cost or at all cost to profitable growth at the lowest cost. And so I've had direct experience with this because after I sold Skubana, I started turning around my e-commerce business, which is called Think Crucial, and we were bleeding money. And with the economy and where things have shaped up, I think it's amplified the fact that we were losing money. So essentially, we've transitioned our entire business in the e-com side to every single activity that we run needs to drive profit. So what did we do? And by the way, I turned around this company. So now we're actually a 10 to 12% operating profit, but we cut all non-performance spend and activities. We focused on our high margin, high AOV product. So we SKU rationalize our entire catalog. We identified value leakage happening from pricing being unoptimized, hence Prophecy. And we've, started pre-packaging a lot of our products, FBA from China, injecting that directly into Amazon's distribution center. And I think the last one I think is very, very important is that we focused on our culture of high execution, and we've done that through L10 meetings. I can go into more detail, but those are sort of the high level things that we've been doing to shift the business to a profit generating business where we have more money in our bank account.
Yeah, and I think in this day and age, you know, you really have to make sure that you know what your profit threshold is for each item. Obviously, if it's a brand new product that you're launching, maybe you're willing to take a dip and you know, risk losing a little bit of money on it. But in general, you want to make sure you know your profit threshold by SKU and make sure you're monitoring that closely. Identify your profit killers and get rid of them. Don't keep restocking them. So just make sure that you're really watching that closely, because especially if you have a lot of SKUs, you can have some profit killers that are just really, really tanking your business without you realizing it. Maybe some of your best sellers, you're really not making much profit on with all the FBA fees, shipping expenses, vendor pricing changes, things like that. You have to really keep a close eye on that just to make sure that you're making profit. So take a look at it on a SKU level. Restock Pro is a tool that has a great FBA SKU profitability report. But just in general, you know, it might even just be that you have to change the packaging of your product. You know, maybe that'll help reduce the FBA fees, but it might also mean you just need to remove that from the shelf, call it quits on that product and find something else. So that would be my tip, is just really know your profit threshold.
Yeah, so on that, I mean, I had 500 SKUs at the start of 2020 at all private label, and now we're down to 250. And so what we did was we established a criteria. So we looked at every SKU, we looked at the aging of those SKUs and how long they would remain and how long it would take, how many days it would take for us to sell through those SKUs. We looked at the profit margin of those SKUs, and we started to really rationalize based on specific metrics that we've set up internally. And we cut our entire portfolio in half. And obviously now we've went from red to black, which is a big, huge shift for us.
Chad, what would you say is the number one profit tip that also helps your Amazon account grow?
I don't know if there's necessarily one specific thing that helped. Oh, so profit tip that also helps it grow. Well, look, I mean, after we did all of that, we earned the right to then invest in new products. One of the things I started playing around with and I started thinking about during the turnaround was I followed everyone's advice, right? Optimize your listings, find somebody to do PPC better for you. I sort of took the playbook, the typical playbook, but the one thing I think most people on Amazon specifically don't talk about is price. We have 250 SKUs now, we had 500, but like, how do we know if we were priced profitably or priced to sell units the same time? And I started changing price and seeing, okay, if I change price up, what happens to BSR? What happens to our competitive positioning? And I started doing this across our SKUs, and it became super time consuming, which is how we started Prophecy. But I think there's an art between maintaining profit and not hurting your Amazon competitive ranking position and affecting your overall share on Amazon specifically. But Steve, I would love to hear from you. What are you seeing? What's your tips?
So are we staying on profit, or are we going to mix profit and growth here?
We're on profit.
Okay. Well, my hands are tied right now, because you can't just focus on profit, because if you're not growing, you're dying, quite frankly. Think of it on a spiritual level. If you talk to your pastor, you talk to anybody, you hear a good sermon, what do they tell you? If you're not growing, you're dying. And so when I think about profitability, it's obviously important. It's a cool thing. Don't get me wrong. But if all you do is profit focus, then you're not going to be able to scale. You're not going to be able to hire more employees. You're not going to be able to think outside the box. And you're probably going to get beat by your competition, because they're going to come in and do things you're not willing to do, like expand SKUs and do a lot of PPC spend on a couple of keywords that get them to organic rank number one. But if you make me talk about profits, I can do it. And if we think about it from this side, if we put profit on a 1 to 10 scale, profit at the cost of growth at 1 and growth at 10 at the cost of profit, what is your number? Right. And if you don't know your number, that is like the biggest action item of today's webinar. You got to decide, what is more important to you? Because the more focus you put on profit, the less focus you can put on growth, and vice versa. And I'm a growth guy. So I don't have a lot of things to say about profit, but I will say this. It's a necessary evil. And my favorite book about profit is Profit First. If you don't take the profit and pay yourself first, then what the heck is the whole point of the entire shenanigans that we're dealing with Amazon right now? Like, I don't want to work for Jeff Bezos. I don't want to go through the motions and then not have a paycheck after all is said and done. So profit's necessary, and profit needs to come first. But if you're not growing, you're dying.
Hey, Caroline. What do you think?
I mean, what Stephen said is very much where I stand in working with Amazon businesses for as long as I have. That
punch him in the gut.
I know, I'm coming for the knockout now. But of course you want profitability, without profitability, your business will die, but the potential for your business is in the growth. And so that's where you need to spend time. And of course, you know, working for Seller's Fi, it seems counterintuitive that I can sit here and talk about profitability, but of course you do need to invest back in your business. And like Colleen said, really getting down to the SKU level and looking at the profitability of single items. I worked for someone previously who was really big in the head, torso, and tail. So your top performers, your mid performers, and the ones that you need to kick out of your catalog. Look at those, see where your money is, because you know you might launch a new product and it isn't going to be profitable immediately. But if you have one of those head products that is performing really well for your business, that's the opportunity to invest in another product. So while you do want to look at the micro level of your products, you're also looking at your business as a whole and seeing if there's opportunity for you to be profitable in one place and maybe not as profitable somewhere else.
All right, now growth. Stephen, I know you're passionate, so I'm going to let you take off here.
There's a lot of things you can do to grow an Amazon business. The fastest and easiest way is to add new products. And as a business owner, if you're not adding new products, you're going to collapse because the Chinese are going to hit you from the left and lower you on price. And they're going to take all of that great patent work you did, all of the great marketing, they're going to copy and duplicate it because that's what they do. And then on the right, you have an injection of billions of dollars coming in from the Amazon aggregators. I mean, half of them are dead already, but you know, still, I mean, they made the PPC cost go up like 27%. But still, like, you're getting hit from the right from the aggregators because they're coming in and ingesting money, injecting it even. And then on the top, you have Amazon just like collapsing down on you and saying, follow our rules, but we're going to give Amazon's choice badge to our own products, right? Click-through rate. I've been talking about click-through rate, CTR, all over the place. Fastest way you can grow your business right now. Take 2 hours. Update your main image. Add some really cool features to it. Show your accessories. Amazon's doing it. Colgate's doing it. HP Printers is doing it. All of the big brands are doing it. And then we get hit with people on social media saying, oh, that's against terms of services. It's really not, because it's helping the customer, and focusing on helping the customer is the fastest way to grow your business. Do what's in the best interest of a customer all times, and you're going to have a business next year and the year after that and 10 years from that. That's what I do at my agency, right? Like, I don't go around and see what other agencies are doing for Amazon clients. I just ask the customer, what do you want? And then I give it to them. That's how you need to treat Amazon. What does the customer want? Give it to them. And that may mean you have to spend some dollars on PPC. That may mean you have to write 500 words of copy on your listing. And, you know, ChatGPT is so hard to use. I can't believe how difficult it is to write copy today. And filling in 100 characters of alt text in my photos. Oh my gosh, there's too much to do. So many things I could be doing it as an Amazon seller, but let's not do the easy free stuff that only requires some time and maybe some VA labor. But those are the things I'm focused on right now. I think 2023 is the year of CTR. And I don't mean choose the right, my fellow friends from Utah. I mean click-through rate.
Yeah, and I'll piggyback on that. I mean, just you know, taking advantage of new programs that are out there. Amazon's always rolling out new programs, and those that tend to be the most successful in them are kind of the early adopters of those programs. One that was just rolled out this week, it was just announced yesterday, is the brand tailored promotions. So take a look at that. There's some information in Seller Central about it. We'll have a blog post up soon. But basically what it is it's a great way to increase your customer base, get more repeat purchases, improve customer retention by creating campaigns that offer anywhere from like 10 to 50% off. You can offer promotional discounts. You can target those who have abandoned cart. You know, they've added products of yours into their cart, but just never purchased them. Customers who have clicked on your products, but never purchased them in the last 12 months. So those are a lot of potential new customers you have not been able to market to in the past. So, you know, take advantage of that program. Again, it's called Brand Tailored Promotions.
Can you enable screen share for me? I'll show you my live results right now.
Yeah.
So Tailor Brand Promotions, super easy to set up. You could come in here and set this up in less than like 5 minutes. You just click this Tailor Promotion button, select the brand. So I've got Age of Sage in here and cart abandoned. So I have 24,000 people who have abandoned in the last 90 days. That means they added it to the cart and they didn't make a purchase. Does that blow your mind? There are 24,000 people that thought my product was cool enough to add to the cart, but didn't hit the purchase button. Mind-boggling how many people are coming and not purchasing. After that, just hit the next button, name the promotion, add a discount, has to be at least 10%, maximum 50, set a budget, and then pick the date. So I'm gonna show you guys, here's my results. So I've made just over $1,600 all in, not a whole lot, but that's an extra $247 in my pocket every single day I wouldn't have normally had, because these people are not coming back. Once you abandon, have you ever gone back to a website after you've abandoned it and did it without getting an email? Like I haven't, like, you know, oh, those Reebok shoes I was looking at the other day, right? Like I'm not going to go back and look, hunt down that website or that Amazon page again, but this is what helps you, because Tailor Promotions will go out there and contact the customer on your behalf. So if you think about it this way, what ACOS are you targeting right now? 35%, 40%? Well, if you just take 10% of your product's price, or 20%, maybe you're a little bit more aggressive and you go up to 25%, that's beating your ACOS goal. That's why I'm doing it. So Tailor Brand Promotions, pretty cool right now.
Very cool. And last year at Amazon Accelerate, they launched tailored audiences. This is kind of the newer thing that they just announced. But, you know, at Amazon Accelerate, that's coming up next month in September, I'll be there. And they always announce new programs there. But again, just be open to trying these new programs. Amazon, most of the time, makes them relatively easy. You know, as Stephen just showed, just point and click and boom, make some money.
But now let's straw man that argument for a second, right? Let's think about what Steve just shared, right? He's sharing a discount, right? We're all things that do what? That incentivizes the wrong behavior on Amazon. And the more that I sell on Amazon, the more I'm part of this community and this ecosystem, the more I realize that we're part of a deceptive system where Amazon really wants you to understand what you make, which is your revenue, and not what you keep, which is your profit, right? There's a reason why Amazon is promoting spending more on Amazon, for example, or giving discounts to their customers, all which benefit the customer, but actually at the end of the day, don't do a whole lot for your bank account. And so one of those reasons why is, like, for example, ACOS or ROAS or other things that we measure PPC campaigns by, these are all revenue embedded metrics, right? These metrics are really designed to keep you asleep, to keep you spending, and to keep your business underperforming, which is why you have all these e-com businesses saddled in some debt. So what I suggest here, right, instead of actually focusing on revenue metrics, right, is to essentially capture all the costs of your customer, everything that costs, the cost of delivery to your customer, the cost to acquire a customer. Instead of steering everything to ROAS and ACOS, which are steering you to spend on easy winning campaigns, it could hide losses, as an example, and create suboptimal spend. use metrics and take those revenue embedded metrics and substitute them with profit embedded metrics and use those profit embedded metrics to drive your intention for a specific product instead of just randomly discounting a product 10%. Again, that's what Amazon wants you to do. Amazon wants you to spend more, increase impressions, and they get a percentage of your revenue. So I guess what I'm suggesting here is to essentially transition your business, right? The highest integrity way to transition your business is to focus on a profit metric and move away from these terms, these vanity, and they're essentially low integrity vanity metrics. ROAS, ACoS, for example, all are things that are revenue dependent. And essentially I'm here to say, hey, let's change that. Let's substitute return on ad spend, which is a revenue metric, with profit on ad spend. And if your profit on ad spend, say, is under one, a POAS of one, that's okay. Maybe you actually want to not be profitable for an advertising campaign for a specific SKU, but be very intentional about how you're spending money. And it doesn't have to be this or that, right? It doesn't have to be profit or growth. It could actually be a mix of both. I have certain SKUs in my mix where we're very focused just on maximizing profit. We don't want to sacrifice our positioning, but we want to focus on profit. There's other SKUs in my mix which are brand new SKUs. They're already past, they're like 3 months live, and we want to get more velocity to them, and we're okay losing money on those specific SKUs.
All right.
That's my 2 cents.
Throw your 2 cents in here.
No, I think this is all, I mean, everyone has made valid points, of course. I think the one thing with growth, I'm going to be a little devil's advocate here, is that you do want to focus. It's so easy to say, look at all these shiny new programs from Amazon. Look at all, we launched Threads. There's TikTok now. And to try all of the things as a means to grow your business, which of course they can help. But if you aren't focusing and going into them with strategy, then you're not going to know how it's affecting. If you do 5 new social media channels this week, how are you going to know? I mean, you should know because you're tracking this information, but you focus on things. It's so easy to get the shiny object syndrome and move elsewhere because you just want to try all of the things that Steven said or Chad said or someone else on Amazon said, that you do what's right for your business. Your audience might not be on TikTok, and that's okay. Just because someone else is doing it doesn't mean it's a fit for your business. So focus there.
I just loaded my first product to TikTok, Seller Central, yesterday. I'm still waiting for my documents to get reviewed. Not really that happy or comfortable sending my bank and credit card statements to the Chinese government officials that are probably looking at them right now. But I always test things, and I don't think TikTok is going to beat Amazon in the next 7 or 8 years. But I want to grow, and it took me only a couple hours to list my application over there. So if you guys haven't started your TikTok Seller Central, I would at least open the account and load your top 2 sellers.
You can definitely test it. I have also tested it personally and ran into a similar situation, but the same thing, just be careful.
I wanted to comment on something Steve said that I thought was interesting around like spirituality and growth, and everyone encouraging like your pastors or religious mentors that are encouraging growth. I think it's important that if you're not centered or grounded, and for example, when I think about being grounded and centered and thinking about profitability, or even just thinking about like dating, right? It's hard to go dating with another woman if you don't have your own stuff together. And so it's important to get your own stuff, like get your house in order first, before you start looking at other channels and other things to explore. So I look at it as like, okay, get your house in order, get firm ground and get your feet planted on the ground, get right internally and get aligned and have clarity. And once you earn that right to go out and to grow and to try other channels, that's awesome. But let's focus on right now getting grounded, because the climate on Amazon has changed dramatically. You know, the aggregators have come into the space, you have inflation happening, you have Chinese sellers coming and saturating the category. So what I'm encouraging is getting aligned and getting clear on your intention, getting grounded in profit, and earning the right so you can go out and explore new channels of growth once the house is in order.
All right, we've got everyone's takes, so we're ready to rumble. Kind of got into some debate there in the beginning, but that's great. And now we're gonna get into, we had a couple of questions teed up, and then I just wanted to encourage you all to keep asking. I see some questions in the chat that are related to some of the questions that we have, so I'll throw those in as we're talking about them. So kick it off, how can sellers effectively balance the need for growth with maintaining profitability? Because I think one thing that we all kind of agreed on is you need both, right? So like Stephen was talking about, finding your number, how do you do that? What steps do you take?
So I'll give a short answer. This is an artisan soap that I sell. Age of Sage, I'm making a brand for every one of my children. So I'm focused like 15 years down the road here, making brands for them. So by the time they take them over, I hope I'm at like 50,000, 100,000 reviews. We'll see what happens. But here is one thing that I would do with my long-term focus for growth. I'm not going to launch 200 cents. I'm not going to overdo the variations. I would be better off launching an entirely new product than adding 20 more variations. So one thing that I'm not going to do to grow is add too many variations. Has anybody made that mistake where you add like 8 colors and you're like, why'd I do that? I still have 90% of my sales on black or blue.
Yeah. And it's to Caroline's point, it's hard to test if you have, if you're doing too much at one time, you know, so.
But I think that they do that, correct me if I'm wrong, Steve, this might be your alley, but they create more variations because then they get the reviews and then you can splice off that product so it becomes an independent parent SKU.
So, I mean, there's a lot of parentage theory we could dive into and bore everybody, but like at the end of the day, if you add X number of cogs, let's say it's going to cost you an extra 30% in cogs to add 7 additional variations. And those cogs only give you the diminishing return of an extra net gain of 10 or 15% gross sales. The return on that extra 30% in cogs is upside down in comparison to the mainstay SKU. Therefore, instead of trying to take your best seller and lift up other non-important colors or variations, scents, flavors, whatever, you'd be better off launching an entirely new product and hitting a niche that you haven't hit previously and expand your customer acquisition. So what I'm trying to say is, I think that the diminishing returns of a color, scent, size variation is not worth the juice required to squeeze it.
Yeah. And what I was going to add to this question too, is just knowing what to restock and when is key to your success on Amazon. So same thing like with how many SKUs you have or how many variations you have, like how many are you forecasting to sell overall or by each child product, but making sure that you strike that balance between having dead stock or stock that's not selling and no stock at all. You don't want to incur Amazon fees, but you also don't want to run out of stock. If there's more people that still want to buy your item and it's just not in inventory, you obviously can't make sales if you don't have any stock to sell. And that can also harm your seller reputation. If sellers can't count on your brand to have products in stock, then they could end up purchasing from a competitor if you don't have something in stock. So making sure that you're forecasting accurately, whether you have a tool or software that helps you with that or an Excel spreadsheet, software is great, but you still need that, human aspect to taking a look at, you know, are your reviews increasing or are the reviews tanking? What's your competitor doing? A lot of things that maybe a tool is not going to tell you. So look at, you know, use a forecasting tool, but also use just your, you know, your human instinct to decide if it's the right time to restock and when, so that you can strike that right balance.
And Kali, I think that's a good point. I just want to just add a comment to that. So I can't tell you how many brands I've talked to on a weekly basis. And a lot of times I think entrepreneurs get caught up with chasing growth, right? They see these top line metrics and it's almost easy, right? They've been asked to chase top line growth because Amazon only shares top line metrics with you in your Seller Central portal. And the amount of brands that I see that come to me and they're stocking out on their Pareto principle, 80% of their profit is coming, 20% of their SKUs, boggles my mind. Like, those brands haven't actually earned the right to go out and chase new SKUs and add them to their portfolio because they can't handle what they got. They can't shake what their mama gave them. I just wanted to add that as a side point, that I think going back to this whole idea of profit and just like working with what you have versus going and chasing these new shiny objects, to me, is a better place to be right now.
If you're a one-man band, your profit margin might be 25%. Might even be better than that. But if you're a million-dollar brand and you've got 3, 4, 5 employees, 15% profit might be pretty solid. And I think Chad's right about this particular issue about stocking, right? If you cannot replenish correctly, then don't launch new products until you get the basics correct. Because the number one rule on Amazon is never go out of stock. And rule two is like rule number one. No, seriously, never go out of stock. Because if you violate rule one or rule two, you're going to have some challenges. So I'll give you an example. So I'm growing my artisan soaps right now, and we were facing a stockout issue on our top two sellers. We'd only been stocking in our warehouse for 90 days supply. And I've been telling the warehouse manager, I'm like, stop doing that. I want you to stock a 12-month supply. He's like, but if I do that, where am I going to put all this stuff? And I said, I don't care. That's not my problem. That's your problem, warehouse guy. But because you only stock 90 days, there was a run on a particular ingredient in my soap, right? I don't know what it was, the coconut oil, the canola oil, the soybean. I don't know which ingredient had a run, but there was a run. And all of the soap production got delayed an extra 6 weeks. And then we started to stock out on our top two sellers. And it took all of my growth and momentum from the year out. And I was so disappointed. So I'm a big proponent in stocking for a year. Most people think that's probably crazy, but I think just-in-time warehousing, just-in-time stock management is dead. And that's because of the crazy world we live in.
I think a lot of this also ties into keeping an efficient business. It's keeping an eye on your metrics and knowing where they are, because maybe you can't do a 12-month. But maybe you have a running 90 days where you're ordering every 45 days, a 90-day supply, and you're just rolling into that. And so it's watching all of that data, running a lean business, because when your business is lean, you do in the right way, you do have the opportunity to become more profitable while growing at the same time, because you can invest back into your business, or you can take on debt if it's needed in order to do that growth, because you are lean and that's all that there is, that cash flow that's moving.
Right. Great answers there. Wanted to change the subject a little bit and talk about common pitfalls. I think that, you know, we've gotten into that a little bit, like Stephen said, rule number one and rule number two, definitely don't want to go out of stock. But what are some other issues that you see sellers facing or that you faced yourself when you're trying to balance growth or profitability or focus on one or the other?
I think I've shared it earlier. I think people chasing brand sellers, chasing top line metrics that are relevant that don't take into account the cost of delivery. They're using revenue as a proxy. So Amazon or agencies or Amazon's partner system, which is all meant to help sellers spend more money, which benefits Amazon, they've been convinced that their goal is to spend more money. They've been convinced that the goal is to enable promotions. They've been convinced that subscribe and save is something that's very good for their brand because they track to something called lifetime value. And in e-commerce, there's no such thing as lifetime. And value, what value are we measuring? Are we measuring profit? No, we're measuring revenue. And so everyone is being steered towards these things that don't really matter at the end of the day and can't be analyzed. And it's hard to analyze. Most agencies don't get into the nitty-gritty of someone's profitability. And to me, being an entrepreneur and doing this for the past 20 years, to me, profit is a fractions game. Profit is something that is in the fringes of your business, in the nooks and crannies. And nobody is going to actually be a steward of your capital the way that you are as a business owner, which means, in my opinion, you should be having a massive list of every single, you should know every single SKU and every profit with every single fee. It should be in your face every single day of the week as you think about your own business.
Wouldn't I just be better paying an expert to manage that profit for me though, Chad?
Well, most experts, Steve, in the Amazon space don't actually care about your profit. They'd care about essentially these fairy tale metrics like ROAS. And by the way, I've heard great things about your agency. Perhaps you actually help people manage the profit, but most, I want to say most, as a waxing statement, most agencies in the Amazon world don't care, right? They're actually probably Amazon partners for a reason, because essentially Amazon has a partner program that enabled these agencies to help them spend more money in the Amazon ecosystem.
I personally would not hire a marketing agency to make me more profitable. I wouldn't do it. I might hire a Chad Rubin, though. maybe having both guys in the room to fight, yeah. And then like you leave the room and say, you guys duke it out, I'll be back. But like, you know, you see a lot of Amazon businesses that don't have accounting support. They don't have a numbers guy. I think every business ever needs three things to run. They need to have finance, operations, and marketing. And we have a room right now where all three of these things are in the same room. So if we made a company right now, we know who would be running what. But at most companies, when they first start, the founder is only in one of those three categories. They're not in two, they're not in three, they're only in one. And when I consider that notion, at some point, you have to bring that second and third expert in. Obviously, you can't do it day one in many instances, unless you take a partner who's not on the payroll initially. But that does kind of violate profit first rules and methodologies. But I think if you have a seat at the table and you say, person A, you run finance, person B, you run marketing, person C, you run operations, and then you cede control of those mechanisms and you put the binders and the blinders and separate it out, you're going to have the best case for long-term scalable success. Because if one beats out the other too much, if Chad gives me a black eye and says, F your marketing, I'm going all in on profit, then next year, I may not even have enough marketing juice left to pay his payroll. Mic drop.
I'm actually going to jump in with some of the commentary from the comments, because I think we've got a little debate happening over here. So Travis said he agreed with Steven, stock inventory out beyond 90 days. In-time stock will kill you. Product can go on a run and move your inventory from 90 days to 30 days. And now you're stuck waiting 60 days to restock. You lose 30 days of sales and all of that momentum. And then Joe came in and said, too much inventory is the largest profit killer.
Both are correct.
Yeah, you turn 4 to 5 times a year, don't have too much capital tied up, can adjust to spikes or drop-offs in demand quick enough without risk of a stock out. And he was talking about his formula for a pipeline. So 30 to 60 days in Amazon, 90 days in your warehouse, 150 on the water or in production. And then I believe we got a question. Yes.
I can't wait until we get rid of China. Like, I cannot wait until manufacturing comes back to the United States of God bless America. Because once we get that, then that 150 days in the water.
Yeah, that's a pipe dream, Steve, unfortunately. And I don't know if anybody on the call has seen the new office that Amazon just built in Hangzhou, China. They have classrooms that they've created in their office specifically to bring factories in to train them on how to actually compete against Amazon US brands. It's unbelievable. If you haven't checked it out, it's the most magical office I've seen. And so to think that manufacturing is going to somehow come back to the United States is to me a pipe dream. There's too much riding on China. Essentially, there needs to be a massive overhaul of our entire economy for that to happen. And I just can't fathom that happening in the current moment. Right. Steve, you're on. I don't know if you're talking, Steve. You're on mute, by the way. Can't hear you.
So there was another question for Steven. Joe had said, when you want to stock for a year at your warehouse, do you account for all of that storage cost in your margin? I've seen too many brands with negative margin because they hold inventory too long outside of Amazon. I think he might.
I think to his point, while Stephen doesn't have his boxing gloves on, essentially, e-commerce brands do not die of starvation. They die of indigestion. And taking on too much product in your warehouse could be, like I think someone said in the comments, could be deadly for your business, right? It's a killer. So I'm just gonna put that out there. Indigestion is the one thing that most Amazon brands die from, based on what I've witnessed and what I've seen.
Going to the backup webcam, Mike. My sword has broken in half, and now I'm pulling out my dagger.
Still here. So just to repeat the question, when you want to stock for a year at your warehouse, do you account for all the storage costs and your margin?
Oh, it's totally killing my margin. There's no question about it. I wish I didn't have to pay for my warehouse, quite frankly. But because I believe so much in trying, like when I say I'm building these brands for my daughter, I'm like this avatar, check this out. Like this avatar, that is literally my daughter, right? So like when I think about what is going to be necessary to run this company 10 or 15 years to compete against these bloodthirsty Chinese over there that are doing everything they can to win and beat the Americans, that's what it's going to take. So because I have that mission, I'm not too concerned about the short-term profit loss, but absolutely it crushes my profits.
Right. And I think when we're talking about common pitfalls and how to balance growth and profitability, like don't lose sight of the basics. You know, you can get really caught up in just a lot of the shiny objects like Caroline said, but just don't lose sight of the basics. You know, as your product line grows, you increase your number of SKUs, making sure that you're monitoring your listings, making sure that they're not being search suppressed because you can lose out on a lot of sales that way. Making sure that, you know, nobody's, you know, hijacking your listings and selling counterfeit items on them. If they are, make sure you get a cease and desist letter out to them immediately. You know, just really keep a close eye on your listings. Because when you have a lot of SKUs, it's easy to lose sight of that when you're busy and caught up with other things. But like Stephen said, you know, there's a lot of people looking to attack. And so making sure that your items are not being hijacked and, you know, somebody else is selling your item as a counterfeit, because that can really damage your brand.
Yeah. And I think Gary's question here is a little bit related to what you were just saying about search suppression. So he said, I'm concerned by changing my product price too radically because I heard that Amazon has developed a pricing bracket. So if prices increase or decrease too much, then it affects ranking. Is that true?
Yeah, so that's actually incorrect. So a few things. It's very rare that Amazon brands ever change price. That's what we noticed. And so I built a repricer and I was actually repricing my own product manually before building a private label brand repricer to maximize profits. And so since brands never change price, we essentially started building in the first 30 days of using Prophecy, something called hyperlearning, where we made small oscillations to price in both directions to see how Amazon reacts, see how your competition reacts, and see how your customers react. Then we take those learnings and we deploy them to the market. So we were making very small, gentle price changes to see how Amazon, your customers, and your competition react. So we're not encouraging massive price swings. We're encouraging small changes. I mean, there's a Harvard Business Review study that was done, a 1% increase in price. By the way, that's not always the optimal decision to increase price on Amazon, but a 1% increase in price can actually increase your operating profit by 14%. So the changes don't have to be massive. But there shouldn't be any fear. I mean, the fear is that everyone has these like notions and I don't know how they get them. Perhaps maybe Amazon has ingrained them into people's brains, but there is some sort of notion where that people have fear that they don't want to change price. So what do? They discount, right? Or they drive more PPC dollars, which again, plays into the hand that Amazon wants you to play into, which is essentially inflating your ego, driving top line revenue, helping your agency look good, but it doesn't do much for your bank account at the end of the day.
Just do what Amazon does, raise your prices and then discount it for Prime Day and call it a discount.
Nice.
And we had someone chime in from the chat and say that if you raise the price too much too fast, you will lose the buy box. They're the brand and that happened to them a month ago. And I know we're seeing, you know, off Amazon pricing. So if you're also selling on Walmart or another platform, having a higher price there can make you lose the buy box. So being aware of that is really important.
But by the way, my tip for that person having the buy box issue, lower the price back down by like 2-5% until you get the buy box back and keep it at that price for another 7 days and then incrementally raise it over the next 2 weeks. And you'll get to your target price. You just need to get some sales at the higher price to move the pendulum up.
But imagine having to do that manually. We have built a system that automates it for you. Just putting that out there.
Awesome.
And built in the listing suppression technology into it. So you actually, it flags it if Amazon is confused or doesn't like some of the pricing, you know, they have certain pricing rules on the back end. So.
Great. All right, we wanted to get into metrics, what's most important. And I've got to say, we have a few questions about metrics. So I'm just going to go ahead and tee one of them up. Is POAS a metric available in Amazon ad dashboard? Please talk about formula and best practices for that metric. And that was asked earlier when we were talking about metrics a little bit.
Okay, so the answer is God, no. Amazon doesn't want you to know what you're keeping at the end of the day because there would be a revolution on Amazon's platform, pretty much, a coup d'etat, so to speak. And so let's just define it, I think, for everybody in the audience, because it's probably a new metric and everybody's been sort of sleeping at the wheel for a while. Not everybody, but many. And so return on ad spend, ROAS, is your revenue divided by your advertising spend. It's you to your ROAS. Now, POAS is your gross profit divided by your ad spend. Now you can use gross profit, you can use contribution profit, but essentially what you want to do is you want to isolate your profit from your ads. And so POAS of one means you're breaking even on your advertising spend. And then a POAS of less than one means you're getting more velocity for that spend. And then a POAS of greater than one means you're actually making money. So for example, a POAS of, let's just say it's 2.3, generates $2.3 in cash, means that you're making about $1.30 for every dollar spent. And so having a well-intentioned idea of what your intention is for a specific SKU is going to maximize value. Essentially, it helps to simplify your decision-making process. So instead of managing everything into a revenue metric like ROAS, this metric actually includes costs of goods sold, for example, shipping fees, Amazon fees, et cetera, into the equation. So I just wanted to put that metric out there, which is profit on ad spend, which I think is new to many out there. I can go through the positives and negatives and why, but essentially really it's about precision, it's about clarity, and it's about unlocking profit at scale around your campaigns.
And then, it looks like Steven is maybe ready to answer this one. Someone said they learned that ACoS is not just irrelevant, but also misleading. They learned that return on marketing costs is the better metric. What do you think?
Yeah, take this one away, man. Hit it home.
Yeah, I mean, so I think it's going back to the same thing we're talking about, which is ACoS is a percentage of revenue, right? And I'm trying to encourage everyone on the phone or on this webinar to replace any revenue metric with a profit metric. So what does that mean is that ACoS, so like, I think Steve and I have talked about this example before, but you can take a $25 product, you can increase the price by 20%. You can take your 20% ACoS and you can increase that by 20%. And essentially you can double your contribution profit at the end of the day by making those tweaks. So ACoS to me is irrelevant because it can't stand alone in its own bubble. It's influenced by price. So if I increase price, I have more ad spend that I can garner to actually advertise more dollars to increase demand because price and demand have an inverse relationship. So yes, ACoS is irrelevant. It also depends on your intention for the specific SKU. And again, my intention and the whole idea of this webinar is around how do we maximize profit? Steve might have more to add to that. But
profit first, best book I read this past month.
And I'll just throw in another metric as well, not as detailed or formula driven, but I will say that reviews are a very important metric, especially when it comes to growing your brand on Amazon, making sure that you not only have good quality reviews or good quantity, but recent reviews are very important. And Amazon has claimed that that is important and goes into the algorithm for, winning the buy box, for your listing to appear in the top of the search results, you know, reviews are critical to your success on Amazon. So making sure that you're requesting reviews on every relevant order, that will help you to grow your brand and in turn, you know, get more profit because people will choose you over your competition if you have more reviews. And then also reviews can be a leading indicator of success or of a decline of a product. So pay attention to your own reviews and your competition. If your competition is starting to have a big rise in reviews and yours are declining or vice versa, that could signal that maybe you need to, you know, either pull back on how much inventory you're stocking or maybe you need to push more inventory into the warehouse. But just making sure that you're keeping a close eye on your reviews as well.
Speaking of reviews on the algorithm, can I share my screen real quick? I'll show you what I think the biggest factors on search engine results are right now. And I put reviews as on the way down in 2023. I think Amazon's going to nerf these. I think they already have, quite frankly. I also think click-through rate is the biggest winner, right? So if you looked at what I had back in 2021 for SEO factors, I had click-through rate all the way down at like 5%. Now I've got it at 17, and I've nerfed reviews. I rebuffed PPC last year, but we've seen some interesting things with the algo in the last year. And if anybody's wondering why we call this the A10, it's just to get the pedantic Amazon experts riled up. It's actually the A9.
All right. We have some questions about being new to Amazon and trying to make more sales. So Corinne, I hope maybe we address some of your questions here. I think that our panelists also have some resources that we'll share at the end that can help you get started. So wanted to talk about strategies that new Amazon brands can use to get started, focusing on either growth or profit or both. Dad, you're up.
So I'm trying to think about what we do internally in my own e-com business. So one of the things, like I mentioned earlier, was we had a drive towards profit. And once we earned the right to invest, we just started building out our own process internally to evaluate new ideas and new strategies. And we built a pretty complex spreadsheet around this. But it takes a lot of upfront research because when I think about it, if Babe Ruth is known as the home run king, right? His home run, I think every at bat, if he had 100 at bats, he had a 7% home run record, I think 7 or 8%. So that means that I don't think many Amazon brands should have that kind of record. And so you have to have more rigor and more discipline around the way that you're investing in your new products to find the sort of ocean opportunity that's not being tackled on Amazon, because I do think Amazon is quite saturated. So finding the niches and the fringes, which is what I mentioned earlier, around maximizing more profit. So for new brands specifically, I think if you're launching a new product, I think that there needs to actually be more of a strategy around ranking, which is definitely not like what I'm very, very, very focused on. We need to rank more, which means driving more dollars and probably driving those dollars unprofitably initially to get more rank. And by the way, I want to second Steve on this click-through rate challenge, which is like making sure your list, like, because Amazon is flooded. If everyone has the same product photos and everyone has the same content that they produce on ChatGPT, like, how do you rise above the noise? And so images, I think, is one amazing way to articulate that. And if your images look the same, I was on the phone with one brand. He sells hangers. I'm not going to say his name. But he was like, hey, we were first to market with this image and the way he did the boxes and the colors and put the colors on the box, and it was made in the United States. And everyone has mimicked that image now, and he no longer stands out in the crowd. And so what I'm encouraging him is like, hey, you need to move, you need to change your images. You need to do it immediately. You need to shift your image strategy, and you need to actually be creative again and come up with a new way to portray your image. Otherwise, you're just gonna get lost in the sea of sameness on Amazon.
I think you need to stand out both as a product as well as a brand. There are opportunities on most Amazon listings, especially through enhanced brand content, that give you the opportunity to tell both a product story as well as your brand story. And we are getting to a time where, yes, people want things as inexpensively as possible, but people also want to do businesses with those that they can relate to. That's why, you know, tap into a social media community, start growing there as a new Amazon brand, find people in your community that you relate to, because then you're going to write your listings for them. You're going to write them as a problem that you solve for your target audience. And that's how you're going to stand out, because you aren't just some tchotchke. You are going to be a brand people want to do business with and a product they want to keep coming back to.
Caroline, with Sellers Fi, I know you all do funding, of course. When sellers are reaching out to you for funding, what are some of the most common reasons or uses of the funds?
That's great. One great thing about our funding, little plug here, there aren't any restrictions on how you use the funds that you get from us. So most commonly, people will come in for inventory. We've had plenty of businesses where they've gotten big orders, potentially from Sam's Club, or they're stocking up for the holidays or anything like that, and they need the cash flow in order to buy the inventory so they can capitalize on the sales. But we also have people that come in if they need to hire holiday staff for their warehouses. There are, of course, expenses that come up in Q3 and Q4 that, you know, if your sales period doesn't hit until November, but you need to hire and bring people on in, you know, September, October, you need the cash flow sooner. So inventory, holiday staff, people will use it for marketing efforts. If you want to test a new platform, like trying out TikTok, or hiring a social media coordinator to grow that community as you're launching, run an influencer campaign. So those are the ones we most commonly see. But of course, you know, we have a blog post about at least 17 different ways that you can use the funding. So sky's the limit for what you need.
And of course, there's Prime Day in the summertime, always in July. You know, Q4 is a big season, but then there's talk of another Prime Day coming up in October. So everybody's kind of keeping their eyes and ears open for Amazon to make that announcement, like they've had an October Prime It'll Day happen. In the previous years. So yeah, they're trying to get ahead and make money ahead of Target, Walmart, and everybody else before Black Friday.
So be prepared. Holidays.
So be prepared. Get your inventory in now so it's ready to send to Amazon in September for that October Prime Day.
Yeah. And to wrap up, our final question, we kind of started to get into this when we were talking about what new brands can do, but I think that was a really good point about images. Is there anything else that brands can do to stand out in a crowded market? Because like we've talked about, Amazon is pretty saturated. There are a lot of copycats. So final chance to throw in your 2 cents.
Innovate your product and make sure you read your negative reviews and sell into the objection. Sometimes a negative review is actually a feature. For example, my artisan soaps here have a very, very large scent presence, pungent, if you were. Some people hate that. So what did I do? I wrote it as a feature and I said, you want the smelliest soap ever? Come buy my soap. What this will do is it'll create a cult brand and people will follow and follow through on it. So I think it's important to focus in on some key features and make sure you level up. If you sell yoga mats, make sure your yoga mats aren't stinky, slippery, or fall apart. We all know what you would need to do if you're gonna create a yoga mat right now. How did I figure this out? I looked at the top seller with 50,000 reviews and I read 2,000 negative reviews.
Yeah, there's a lot to learn from negative reviews. And oftentimes it gives you an opportunity for bundling or kidding too. If they say, I wish this yoga mat had a strap or had like something else that came with it, or, you know, then maybe you can sell two of those things or create a new product. So there's a lot to be learned from your own negative reviews and your competition.
And I think just to put a period on that or a comma or exclamation point, I would say that when you look at garlic press as an example, you'll see that they're typically $7.99 to $11.99, but then you'll see a garlic press for $29.95. And that is the perception of value, right? They've actually added more nuance and more things to increase the value and to get a premium for their product. So that could actually happen by looking at those reviews to enhance and enrich your listing.
Someone was asking in the chat if they said that reading 10,000 reviews is basically impossible. Is there a ChatGPT extension for this?
There's a specific tool that I tested and did a video on this last week. It's called Genie AI. You can use the free version to do exactly this thing. So if you guys want to just Google Genie AI, my Amazon guy, you'll see the video. I'll put a link in the chat if you want.
Yeah, with Feedback 5, you can just put the ASIN in Feedback 5 so you can get a list of all of those reviews in an Excel spreadsheet format, import it into a Word cloud or a tool like that, and then it makes it really easy.
Just on that, Colleen, I think you can probably take the spreadsheet. If you do that through your tool, you can use probably Code Interpreter on ChatGPT. You can upload that CSV file and then have it analyze it and then create cloud bubbles or other words or negative features for you as well.
Yeah, a lot of cool Great. Stuff. All right, so we kind of already got to questions. I see there are still some more comments. Steven shared his video, which is awesome.
My video won't go to the chat if you could post it in there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and we can put that in the follow-up email as well, since we'll be sending the recording out to everybody.
Yep, for sure. So I just wanted to thank all of our presenters for taking their time to be here today and sharing their expertise. We've got some special offers for you. I'll include these in the newsletter or in the recording as well. So for Ecom Engine, we're offering $15 off your first month of Feedback 5. There are a lot of really great features to help you get more reviews and analyze the reviews that you've got. So feel free to check it out. Steven's offering a free professional audit of one of your ASINs. So this is a really cool in-depth video going through opportunities to increase traffic and other things that you can do to grow. Seller Spy, as I mentioned earlier, there was some questions about getting started on Amazon. And I think this free Amazon Resources Hub that we're going to include in the email will be a really great place for you to start. And if you have questions about getting started with your business, I'm sure anyone on this call would be more than happy to help you. So feel free to contact any of us and we'll send you some resources. And then Prophecy is offering the ultimate Amazon price optimization spreadsheet. And like I said, we'll include all that in the recording. And once again, I want to thank everyone for being here today and our presenters for participating.
Yeah, we'll thanks so much, everybody.
Thank you, guys.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you. We're
a webinar that ends on time. What is this?
For once.
Bye, guys.
Bye.